The calcium score or the calcium scan is a test that can give us a sense of our risk of heart disease. It's basically a CAT scan. We lie down on a stretcher, we slide inside that hollow tube, and it scans the wall of the arteries that take blood to our heart muscle, what's called the coronaries. And it can detect calcium, basically bone, in the wall of those arteries. Now, that's not supposed to happen normally in healthy arteries. There is no calcium in the walls, but as plaque, as atherosclerosis, as heart disease develops and builds over years, sometimes calcium will develop and can be detected with this scan. So the calcium score does not detect all plaque. It doesn't detect soft plaque. There's actually other tests for that. We'll talk about that in a second. But it can give us a general idea of how much plaque we have and how long it's been building. Basically, how far along the process we are. If the calcium score is above zero, and the higher it is, the longer plaque's been there, and the more widespread it probably is in our arterial tree. Now, this is interesting to find out, but at the end of the day, what we care about are the actual events, heart attacks and strokes. And we've known for a long time, there are many studies showing that people who have higher calcium scores have a higher risk of having an event, like a heart attack or a stroke. But sometimes this can lead to misunderstandings. For example, people might think, well, a higher calcium score is usually bad news. So if I have a calcium score of zero, I'm safe. I have zero risk. A calcium score of zero does mean low risk for a good while, but not zero risk and not lifelong, not forever. In fact, there's a study that just came out this year. Actually, I guess it was last year since it's already 2025. Happy New Year, by the way. So a study came out last year that showed that even among people with a calcium score of zero, those that had higher levels of LDL cholesterol had a higher risk of having plaque in their carotid arteries, the arteries taking blood up to the brain. 43% higher, to be specific. Now, LDL cholesterol is kind of a dirty metric, as regular viewers know. A better metric is ApoB. They don't report ApoB. They do report non-HDL cholesterol, which is a simple calculation. You take your total cholesterol, you subtract your HDL cholesterol, and you have your non-HDL cholesterol. It's a pretty good measure of heart disease risk, better than LDL cholesterol. And for non-HDL cholesterol, those with an elevated level had a 39% higher risk of having more plaque in their carotids. So this is a pretty interesting illustration that even with a calcium score of zero, you can still have plaque and it can be growing, the soft type of plaque, right? The non-calcified plaque, which is actually the worst. It's actually the most likely to rupture. Now, these results are interesting, but they don't measure actual events. Number of heart attacks, number of strokes, etc. And at the end of the day, that's what we care about. So there's another study that just concluded, was just presented, the data was just presented at a meeting, and it actually did look at events in the context of this question. Basically, they followed a population of 3,000 people, young adults, and in those who had a calcium score of zero at the age of 40, this is average of the population. They followed them forward prospectively for another 19 years. So from 40 to 59, average. And about 5% of them had an event, like a heart attack or a stroke or death or something like that. So it is a minority. As we said, a calcium score of zero means a low risk, at least for some time, but not zero, right? Not zero risk. That's the point. I was actually surprised by this. The number seemed too large for me, larger than what I expected, because 5% is 1 out of 20. And these people are pretty young. They're in their 40s or 50s. When I say pretty young, it's because it's my age range. 47, I'm going to be 48 in a couple months. And the thought of having a heart attack or a stroke over the next 5 to 10 years is pretty daunting. So then they wondered, okay, what distinguishes these people that have the events from the ones that get away with it? Because they all have a calcium score of zero. And so one thing they looked at was their LDL cholesterol level. And so again, for people who are 40 average and have a calcium score of zero, they asked if their average LDL cholesterol leading up to that age, so from 25 to 40 years old, kind of averaging the LDL cholesterol over that entire period, does that explain their risk of having an event from 40 to 59? And the answer was no. They found no significant association between those two factors. However, when they looked at 50-year-olds, So average of 50, still everybody with a calcium score of 0 at the average age of 50. Does their LDL cholesterol leading up to that age, so from 25 to 50, average LDL cholesterol during that whole period, does that explain their likelihood of events going forward from 50? And they found that yes, the higher their average LDL cholesterol leading up to 50, the higher the likelihood that they would have an event in the following decade, from 50 to about 59. Now, like we said, LDL cholesterol, kind of a rough measure. They don't report ApoB or non-HDL cholesterol. So grain of salt there, the numbers for those metrics might look different. Why was there no significant association starting at 40, but there was one starting at 50? Possibly because cholesterol levels are still low when people are younger and they tend to rise later in life. So you pick up that association if you shift the window a little later. Okay, their risk is higher of having an event. How much higher? This always hinges on the details, on the specifics of the population. So I talked to the authors about this. They were super nice, super helpful. Dr. Giannos and Dr. Peng, both cardiologists at Northwell and Johns Hopkins, respectively. And so one example they gave me from their data was an increase from 100 milligrams per deciliter LDL cholesterol to 140. This difference, if maintained for 25 years, for example, from the age of 25 to 50, would be expected to raise risk by 60% in the following decade, from 50 to about 59. And then for an even bigger difference, we'd expect a bigger increase in risk. For example, we'd expect a doubling of risk comparing 110 to 177 milligrams per deciliter LDL cholesterol over the same time span. Okay, a doubling of risk, what does that actually mean in real life, in actionable terms? As we saw, the average was 5% of people, give or take, had an event, so 1 out of 20. So if that were to double, it would become about 10 to 11%. So 1 out of 10 people would have an event. And then for a smaller difference in cholesterol, a smaller difference in risk. And they said they started to see risk going up at about 100 milligrams per deciliter LDL cholesterol. Before that, not much difference. And then crossing that threshold of 100, they start to see risk drift up. So still a minority of people, even if the risk were to double, still the vast majority of people would not have an event, at least over that time span. And so, yeah, that's the take-home message. With a calcium score of 0 over 10 to 20 years, it's a minority of people that have an event, but it's not 0. Also worth bearing in mind, these people are young. They're in their 40s and 50s, and risk is going to go up with age. We know that. It's abundantly clear. So if exposure continues, the risk keeps going up. My message is not that this is a really high number, so you should be scared, nor is it that it's a really low number and you should ignore it. That's for you to decide. That's for you to know according to your personal goals, for you to make these decisions with your doctor. The point is to give you the information we have, these data that scientists figure out, so you can make your own informed choice. In fact, I was just talking to somebody on Twitter the other day, and they said, look, I don't go by hot takes on social media. This is important to me. I went into one of these risk calculators, legit ones put out by cardiology associations. I put in my data. I calculated my risk, and I'm okay with that number. Even though my risk factors aren't ideal, but I'm okay with that number. I can tolerate that. And that's a great example of an informed decision. Is it the same decision that someone else would make? No, but it's the right choice for that individual, right? That's medicine. You make a decision based on the evidence that fits your goals and your perspective and your preferences. Okay, the last thing to bear in mind is what we call conversion. So conversion refers to someone who has a calcium score of 0, and then over time it becomes non-zero. And this is kind of an obvious realization, but an interesting thing to bear in mind, that everybody who has a high calcium score, at some point in their life, it was 0, right? As a child, it was 0. So everybody who is a non-zero went through this conversion. For example, in this data set that we've been talking about that was presented at the meeting, at 40, 90% of people had a calcium score of 0. But at 50, it was about 70% of people that did. So almost 20%, almost 1 out of 5, developed a detectable calcium score over those 10 years, during their 40s, essentially. And they also found that people who had higher LDL cholesterol had a higher risk of conversion. Specifically, 10% higher for each 10 points, 10 milligrams per deciliter LDL cholesterol. So the epiphany here is that a calcium score of zero is not a fundamental characteristic of someone. It's a current state. My current calcium score is zero, but that can change in the future. And whether it changes or not is affected by risk factor exposure. Now, one option is to measure your calcium score every few years, every 3 years or every 5 years. Do like a serial calcium scan. That's pretty doable. The test is relatively cheap, $100, $200, depending where you are. Some doctors recommend doing this, kind of keep an eye on it and see if it pops up. Personally, I wouldn't be very happy with this strategy because we're picking it up at a pretty late stage. I would want to know that I have plaque earlier on. Ideally, I'd want to avoid plaque in the first place. But know that this is something, it's an option that's out there, and some doctors do recommend it. Okay, if I want to test if I have soft plaque, a more sensitive test, what options do I have? One test is the CTA, computed tomography, angiography. It's more sensitive. It can detect soft plaque. It's also a lot more expensive. It's about 10 times more expensive. It's also a bit more invasive because it does involve getting contrast injected into your bloodstream, but it's a more sensitive option out there to detect soft plaque. Another option is the carotid ultrasound. I've gotten that one before. It's pretty cheap, completely uninvasive. You have the ultrasound probe just rubbing lightly on your neck, same as any other ultrasound. And it looks at the structure of the wall of the artery, can show you if the wall of the artery is thickened or not, if there's plaque or not. So those are some options. Again, just to give you an idea of, to illustrate with my personal example, my calcium score is zero. So I did get the test. So obviously I don't think it's useless. I think it does provide relevant information. Now, do I think that's very reassuring? I don't. Basically because having a calcium score of zero is the norm at my age range in the 40s. And that's even in a society where cardiovascular disease is the number one cause of death. So yeah, having a calcium score of zero in your 40s is better than if it had come out 200, but it's kind of a low bar. It doesn't relax me that much. It means it's unlikely that I'll have a heart attack or a stroke over the next 10 years, probably even 20-ish years, which is good, but not zero. That probability is not zero. And also, I want to live longer than that if I can. So I still very much am mindful of risk factors, even with a calcium score of zero. It doesn't make me Superman. The calcium score is particularly useful in three situations. One is a young individual who has a calcium score that's high. So someone's 30 or 40 and has a calcium score of 50 or 100 or even higher. That's very meaningful because it tells us, okay, this person at this age already has pretty advanced plaque that's been growing probably for decades. So this is an individual with very high susceptibility. We need to be pretty aggressive, pretty attentive here. The other one is the other end of the spectrum. Someone who's older and still has a calcium score of zero. The older you are, the more meaningful a calcium score of zero is. So you're 75 or 80 or 85, especially if you were exposed to some risk factors, your cholesterol wasn't great throughout your life, or you smoked or something like that, and your calcium score is zero at an advanced age, yeah, that tells me that person probably has pretty good genes, doesn't have susceptibility. I'm going to be less worried. And the third case are borderline situations. So situations where the person is considering starting therapy, for example, but is on the fence, they maybe don't want to if they don't have to. You do a calcium scan. If it's positive, that's an argument for being more aggressive. If it's not positive, the urgency is lower. So to summarize everything, a calcium score of zero means low risk for 10 years, maybe even 20 years, but not zero, and it does go up with time. As the authors themselves worded it in their presentation at the meeting, in young adults with a calcium score of zero, long-term cumulative exposure to LDL cholesterol remains independently associated with an increase in cardiovascular disease events and development of future calcium score. That's the conversion we talked about. While the risk is low for those with calcium score of zero, it is detectable over longer exposure to greater cumulative LDL cholesterol, confirming the continued importance of long-term LDL cholesterol control. And I would add all risk factors: tobacco, fasting glucose, blood pressure, ApoB rather than LDL cholesterol, etc. For more on the calcium score, we covered the top myths around it in a previous video, and I'll link that right here. And if you have questions about heart disease and insulin resistance, we have a whole video on that. I'll link that right here. Check them out. I'll meet you in there. Take care.